Later, Connie was in one of the Ragby lumber rooms when she remarked to Mrs. Bolton, on touching an old family cradle there, that she might yet have a use for it. I might have a child. Oh, dear, Mrs. Bolton was thinking to herself. Is it Oliver Mellor's child you're preparing for? Later that day, Mr. Betts drove Mrs. Bolton to her house in the village. She was having a few friends in to admire the escritoire outfit Constance had given her. They thought it marvellous, and then started to whisper about Lady Chatterley's child. "Wonders'll never cease," said Mrs. Whedon, the under-cashier's wife, for Mrs. Bolton was convinced if it did come, it would be Sir Clifford's child. Before long, Clifford himself also began to believe it possible that it might even be his child. He asked his wife, "Connie, did you know there was a rumour in the village that you're going to supply Ragby Hall with a son and heir?" Connie felt dim with terror, yet she stood quite still, touching the tall yellow tulip she was arranging. "No," she said. "Is it a joke or malicious gossip?" "Neither, I hope," he answered. "I hope it may be a prophecy." Connie went on with her flowers and mentioned she wished to go with her father to Italy. "Do you mind?" she concluded. "For how long will you be away?" "Perhaps 3 weeks." There was a silence for a time. "Well," said Clifford eventually, "I suppose I could stand it for 3 weeks, but only if I were absolutely certain you'd want to come back." "I should want to come back," she said quietly, with conviction. Somehow Clifford believed her. He felt immensely relieved, joyful at once. "I do wish you'd come," she asked him. She would so love to make him happy. Clifford shook his head. "Not this year, my dear. Not this year. Next year, I'll probably try." She went away gloomily. It was May, but cold and wet again. The country was dismal. It was chilly, and there was smoke on the rain, a feeling like exhaust vapour in the air. Connie went out to Tevershaw. When she arrived, there was something uncanny and underground about it all, as though it were an underworld. When she saw the great lorries full of steelworkers from Sheffield, weird, distorted, smelling beings like men off for an excursion to Matlock, her stomach weakened and she thought, "Oh, God, what has man done to man? They've reduced them to less than humans. And now there can be no fellowship anymore. It's a nightmare." She again felt a wave of terror, the grey, gritty hopelessness of it all. There was no hope, no hope any more. Yet she wanted a baby, an heir to Ragby. She shuddered with dread. Yet Mellors had come out of all this. Yes, but he was as apart from it all as she was. And this was England, the vast bulk of England as Connie knew, since she'd motored from the centre of it. She went on to Staxgate, new on the face of the earth since the war. Since Connie's arrival at Ragby Hall, this new town had arisen, and the model dwellings had been filled with riffraff who had drifted in from anywhere to poach Clifford's rabbits, among other disreputable occupations. Her car sped by and ran on along the uplands where she could see the rolling county spread out. The county. It had once been proud and lordly. In front of her loomed the splendid Elizabethan bulk of Chadwick Hall, more wall than window. Noble it stood alone, above a great park, but now out of date and passed over. It was still kept up, but only as a showplace, a reminder of the past. The present lay below. God alone knew where the future lay. The car descended to Uthwaite, down in the valley, with all the steel threads of the railways to Sheffield drawn through it, and the coal mines and the steelworks sending up their smoke and glare from long tubes. There was the pathetic little corkscrew spire of the church that was going to tumble down, still pricking the fumes, and which always affected Connie strangely. Once you got down into the twisted and crooked heart of the town behind the church, you were in the world of 2 centuries ago, immediately following the old crooked streets of oldish blackened miners' dwellings, were crowded pink rows of larger houses plastering the valley, homes to the modern workmen. Behind that again were patch after patch of raw red brick, showed the newest mining settlements. Between were the tattered remnants of the old coaching and cottage England. This was history. One England erases another. The mines had made the halls wealthy, and now they were blotting them out, as they had already blotted out the cottages. Industrial England was removing the agricultural England. Connie herself clung to the remnants of old England. It had taken her years to realise that it was affected out by this terrifying new and gruesome England, and that this effacement would continue until the change was complete. And what would come after? Connie could not imagine. She could only see the new brick streets spreading into the fields. The younger generation were already utterly unconscious of the old England. There was a gap in the continuity of consciousness, which seemed almost American, but in reality was about industry. What next? Connie always felt there was no next. She wanted to hide her head in the sand. The world was so complicated and weird and gruesome. The common people were so many, and really so terrible, she thought, as she was going home and saw the colliers trailing from the pits, grey-black, distorted, scuffing along in their heavy iron-shod boots. Men. Men. In some ways, patient and good men. In other ways, non-existent. Something that man should have was bred and willed out of them. Yet they remained men. They begot children. One might bear a child to them. Connie was utterly intimidated by the industrial masses. They seemed so weird to her. A life with utterly no beauty in it, no intuition, always in the pit. Yet had not Mellors come from such a father? Not quite, for 40 years had made a difference, an appalling difference in the pitman. The iron and coal had eaten deep into the bodies and souls of these men. What would become of them all? Perhaps with the passing of coal, they would disappear again, disappear off the face of the earth. Perhaps they were only a weird and temporary fauna from the coal seams. Connie was glad to be home, to once again close her eyes to the new world. She was even glad to babble to Clifford, for her fear of the mining and iron Midlands affected her with a queer feeling that went all over her like influenza. The next day, coming downstairs in the morning, she found the keeper's dog, Flossie, sitting in the corridor outside Clifford's room. "Why, Flossie," she said softly, "what are you doing here?" And she quietly opened Clifford's door. Clifford was sitting up in bed, and the keeper was standing to attention at its foot. "Oh, good morning, Clifford," Connie said. "I didn't know you were busy." Then she looked at the keeper, saying good morning to him. He murmured his reply, looking at her vaguely. But she felt a whiff of passion touch her from his presence alone. "Did I interrupt you, Clifford? I'm sorry." "No, it's nothing of any importance," he replied. She soon slipped out of the room, back up to her bedroom. She sat at the window and saw Mellors go down the drive. He had a natural sort of quiet distinction, an aloof pride, and yet also a look of frailty. A hireling, that's what he was. What did he really think of her? It was a sunny day, and Connie was working in the garden with Mrs. Bolton helping her. It was work they both enjoyed. Connie spoke about Mr. Bolton, and Mrs. Bolton was happy to talk of him. "I believe, unbeknown to himself, he hated the pit, just hated it. He looked so quiet when he was dead, as if he got free. He was such a nice-looking lad. It just broke my heart to see him, still and pure-looking, as if he wanted to die. Oh, it broke my heart, it did. But it was the pit." She wept a few bitter tears, and Connie wept with her. "It must have been terrible for you," she remarked. "Oh, my lady, I never realised it at first. I kept expecting him back, especially at nights. It was as if my feelings wouldn't believe he'd gone. I just felt he's got to come back and lie against me, so I could feel him with me. That was all I wanted. And it took 1,000 shocks before I knew he wouldn't come back. It took me years." "It's terrible once you've got a man into your blood," said Connie. "Oh, my lady, and that's what makes you feel so bitter. You feel other folks wanted him killed. You feel the pit wanted to kill him. There's a lot of hard-hearted folks in the world, and every morning when he got up and went to the pit, I felt it was wrong, wrong. But what else can a man do?" Hate flared in the woman's face. "But can love last so long?" Connie asked suddenly. "Oh, my lady, what else is there to last? Children grow away from you. We might have drifted apart, who knows? But the feeling's something different. When I look at women who've never been worn through by a man. Well, they seem to me poor dull owls, no matter how they may dress up and gad about. Connie went to the wood directly after lunch. It was a lovely day. Everywhere the buds and the leap of life made itself felt in the warm yellow of summer. The keeper was not at the hut. Connie walked on towards the cottage because she wanted to find him. The cottage stood in the sun at the wood's edge. There was a bark of a dog and Flossie came running up to her. The door was wide open, so he was at home. And the sunlight falling on the red brick floor, she saw him eating at the table. "May I come in?" she asked. "Come in. Shall you have something? Shall you have a cup of tea?" "Only if you let me make it myself," she responded. He seemed sad, and she felt she was bothering him. "It's lovely here," she remarked. "Such a beautiful stillness. Everything alive, yet still." He was eating again, while she made a cup of tea in silence. She poured it out, but paused, holding the cream jug. "No milk," he said. Then he seemed to hear a noise, and looked keenly through the doorway. "And we'd better shut it," he said, nodding at the door. "It seems a pity," she replied. "Nobody will come, will they?" "Not unless it's one time in a thousand, but you never know." "But it's no matter, it's only a cup of tea," she paused. "Are you sad today?" "Sad? No, bored. I had to go getting summonses for two poachers I caught, and, oh well, I don't like people," he said with anger. "Do you hate being a gamekeeper?" "No, so long as I'm left alone. But I have to go messing around at the police station and waiting for a lot of fools to attend to me, well, I get mad," he smiled. "I've got to work or I should die. I'm not in good enough temper to work for myself. It's got to be a sort of job for somebody else. So altogether, I'm very well off here, especially lately." "I'm going away for a while next month," she said, "to Venice, for a month or so. Clifford won't go. He hates travel in his condition." "Aye. Poor devil," he said with sympathy. There was a pause. "You won't forget me when I'm gone, will you?" she asked. He looked at her. "Forget," he said. "You know nobody forgets." She responded in a mute kind of voice. "I told Clifford I might have a child." He looked up at her, intense and searching. "You did? What did he say?" "Oh, he wouldn't mind. He'd be glad, really. So long as it seemed to be his." He was silent a long time. At last he said, "No mention of me, of course." "No, no mention of you. I said I might have a love affair in Venice." "You might," he replied slowly. "So that's why you're going." "Not to have a love affair," she said. "Just the appearance of one, then," he commented. There was a silence. Suddenly he asked, "That was why you wanted me, then, to get a child?" She hung her head. "No, not really." "Well, it's as your ladyship likes. If you get the baby, Sir Clifford's welcome to it. I shan't have lost anything. On the contrary, I've had a very nice experience. If you've made use of me, it's not the first time I've been made use of."
"But I didn't make use of you," she pleaded. "I liked your body."
"Did you?" he replied, laughing. "Well then, we're quits, because I liked yours. Would you like to go upstairs now?"
"No, not here. At the hut, I must go."
He said nothing. She went down the path and he stood in the doorway, faintly grinning. She was divided between two feelings, resentment against him and a desire to make it up with him. After tea, she could neither sit nor stand. She would have to go back to the hut. If he was not there, all well and good. She slipped out of the side door. When she came to the clearing, she was terribly uneasy. But there he was again. She went straight to him.
"Shall us go with the hut?" he asked.
"Do you want me?" she asked, not mistrusting him.
"Aye, if you want."
She was silent for a moment, then went with him to the hut. Cold and derisive, her mind stood apart. Though she lay still, her impulse was to escape the man's ugly grip. His body seemed a foolish, imperfect thing. And yet when he had finished, she began to weep. At first he seemed to take no notice, but the storm inside her swelled and shook her, shaking him.
"Aye," he said softly. It was no good that time. You wasn't there. Her sobs became violent. But what's amiss? He went on. I can't love you, she sobbed.
Well, dinna fret. There's no law says that that's got to. Take it for what it is.
She wept bitterly. But I want to love you. And I can't. It seems horrid. He laughed a little, half bitter, half amused.
It isn't horrid, he said. Dunna fret thysen about loving me. Thou must take the roof with a smooth.
At that instant she hated his dialect. Yet as he was drawing away to rise silently and leave, she clung to him in terror. Don't go. Don't leave me. Don't be cross with me. Hold me, she whispered, clinging to him. He took her in his arms again and drew her to him. Her resistance was gone, and she began to slide into a marvellous peace. She felt herself melting in the flame of desire, and she let herself go. Her terror subsided. She dared to let everything relax, every part of herself. It seemed she felt like the sea. At first, nothing but dark waves, rising and heaving with a dead swell, but with the ebbing of the tide, she realized all her loveliness. Her body clung with tenderness to the unknown man. It was so lovely, she moaned this time. But he said nothing, only softly kissing her, lying still above her. When awareness of the outside began to filter back, she clung to his breast, murmuring, my love, my love. He held her silently, with a silence that was fathomless. Where are you? She whispered to him. Speak to me. Say something to me. He kissed her softly, whispering, I'm alas. But she did not know what he meant. In his silence, he seemed lost to her. You love me, don't you? She murmured.
Neither knowst, he said.
But tell me, she pleaded. Say you'll always love me.
Aye, he said abstractedly.
She felt her questions driving him away from her. Must we get up? He asked at last. No, she said. But she could feel his consciousness straying, listening to the noises outside.
It'll be nearly dark, he said.
She kissed him. He rose, turned up the lantern, and quickly pulled on his clothes. He stood there above her, looking down at her with dark, wide eyes, his face a little flushed and his hair ruffled. It made her want to hold him again, for there was a warm, half-sleepy remoteness in his beauty that made her want to cry out and clutch him, to have him. But she knew she would never have him. You do believe I love you? She asked.
You love me just now, but who knows what'll happen once I start thinking about it.
No, don't say those things.
Ah, well, he said. This what best?
She lay still as he softly opened the door to let in the dark blue sky. He went out to shut up the hens. She remained where she was and wondered. A little later he returned, and she agreed to visit him on Sunday. As she ran home in the twilight, the world seemed a dream. The trees in the park and the slope to the house seemed alive. On Sunday, Clifford wanted to go to the wood. It was a lovely morning. It was cruel for him, while the world blossomed, to have to be helped from his chair to the bath chair. Connie still suffered, having to lift his inert legs into place. As they passed the front of Ragby Hall, Clifford remarked,
I hope I can have some repairs done to the old place next year. I think I shall have about 1,000 to spare for that. But such work costs so much.
Oh, good, said Connie, as long as there aren't more strikes.
What would be the use of their striking again? Merely ruin what's left of the industry.
Perhaps they don't mind ruining the industry, replied Connie.
Ah, don't talk like a woman. The industry fills their bellies, even if they can't keep their pockets quite so flush. There'll be no more strikes if the thing is properly managed.
But will the men let you? Connie asked.
We shan't ask them. We shall do it while they're not looking. For their own good, to save the industry. I can live without the pits, but they can't. They'll starve if there are no pits, but I've got to make other provisions.
But will the men let you dictate terms? Asked his wife.
My dear, replied Clifford, they'll have to, if one does it gently.
They realise that the industry comes before the individual. Somebody's got to be the boss of the show. But who is the boss of the show, she asked. The men who own and run the industries. There was a long silence. At last, Connie said, It seems to me they're a bad boss. They don't take their position seriously enough. They take it far more seriously than you take your ladyship, Clifford retorted. That's thrust on me. I don't really want it, she blurted out. Ah, but that's just funk. You've got it, you're fated to it, and you should live up to it. Who's given the colliers all they have that's worth having? Who's given it to them? Have the colliers given it to colliers? No. All the Ragbys and Shipleys in England have given their part and must go on giving. There's your responsibility. Connie listened and flushed very red. I'd like to give something, she said, but I'm not allowed to. Everything must be sold and paid for now. Everything must be sold at a good profit. You don't feel one heartbeat of real sympathy for them. And besides, who has taken away from these people their natural life and given them this industrial horror? Why is Tevershall so ugly, so hideous? Why are their lives so hopeless? They built their own Tevershall. That's part of their display of freedom. They live their own pretty lives in their own pretty Tevershall. I can't live their lives for them. But you make them work for you. They live the life of your coal mine. Not at all, responded Sir Clifford. Not one man is forced to work for me. Their lives are industrialised and hopeless, and so are ours, Connie cried. I don't think they are. You don't look at all a hopeless figure standing there, Connie, my dear. Which was true. She looked full of rebellious passion, far from dejected hopelessness. She wondered with rage why it was she felt Clifford was so wrong, yet she could not explain exactly why he was wrong. No wonder the men hate you, she remarked. They don't, he replied, and don't fall into the trap of mistaking the sense of the word. They're not men, they're animals you don't understand and never could. Don't thrust your illusions on other people. What we need to take up now is ships, not swords. The masses have been ruled since time began, and till time ends, ruled they will have to be. It's sheer hypocrisy and farce to say they can rule themselves. But can you rule them? She asked. I? Oh, yes. Neither my mind nor my will is crippled. I can do my share of ruling. Give me a son, and he will be able to rule his portion after me. But he wouldn't necessarily be your own son, of your own ruling class, she stammered. I don't care who his father is, as long as he is a healthy man, not below normal intelligence. I'll make a perfectly competent Chatterley of him. When it comes to expressive or executive functions, I believe there is a gulf, an absolute one between the ruling and serving classes. The two functions are opposites, and it is the function that determines the individual. Connie looked at him with dazed eyes. He'd had his say. Now he lapsed into his peculiar, rather vacant apathy that Connie found so trying. In the wood, anyway, she was determined not to argue. They passed the narrow track to the hut. Thank heaven it was not wide enough for the chair. The chair reached the bottom of the slope and swerved round, only to disappear. Connie heard a low whistle behind her. She glanced sharply round. The keeper was striding downhill towards her. "Is Sir Clifford going to the cottage?" he asked. "No, only to the well." "Ah, good. Then I'll keep out of his sight. But I'll see you tonight. I shall wait for you at the park gate about 10. He stared directly into her eyes. "Yes," she faltered. She looked at him, frightened, and started running down the hill, cooing, cooing again to Clifford. The man above watched her, then turned, grinning faintly, back onto his path. Connie found Clifford close to the well. How silent and gloomy it seemed there. "Will you have a drink?" Clifford asked Connie. "Will you?" She took an enamel mug from a twig on a tree and stooped to fill it for him. He drank in sips. Then she stooped again and drank a little herself. "It's icy," she said, gasping. "Good, isn't it? Did you make a wish?" "Yes," I wished. "But I'm not telling you what." Then they started on the return journey. The chair balked, then stopped a little way up the slope. In exasperation, Clifford sounded his horn for Mellors. The keeper appeared immediately and examined the engine. "There's certainly nothing obvious broken," he remarked. Clifford started the motor again, which seemed to go better this time. "If I give her a push, she'll do it by herself." He kept fiddling with his engine. Suddenly the chair charged forward and with a sick lurch sideways tumbled into the ditch. "Clifford!" cried Connie, rushing forward. But the keeper had already got hold of the chair by the rail, pushing from behind as the chair now chugged up the hill. "You see, she's doing it!" exclaimed Clifford, victorious, glancing over his shoulder. He saw the keeper's face. "Are you pushing her?" "She won't do it without." "Let her alone. I asked you to let me try." demanded Clifford. The keeper stood back and the chair stopped. Clifford, seated, a prisoner, was white with vexation. She would not budge. He stopped the engine and sat rigid with anger. Connie sat on the bank, remembering some of her husband's words. What we need to take up now is whips, not swords, the ruling classes. The keeper strode up, then lay on his stomach and examined the engine. Try her again, he said patiently, quietly. Clifford tried her. She was going once more. Mellor stepped behind and began to push. Clifford glanced round, yellow with anger. Look, you, get off there! The man pulled back. He'd finished. The chair began slowly to run backwards. The two onlookers rushed forward. The chair now stood still. I expect she'll have to be pushed, agreed Clifford at last. There was no answer. Do you mind pushing her home, Mellors? He ordered, in a cool, superior tone. I hope I've said nothing to offend you. Nothing at all, Sir Clifford, Mellors replied. But the brake was stuck. Mellors pulled at the wheel. At last the brake gave and the chair reeled. For God's sake! Cried Clifford in terror. The keeper put a stone under the wheel, then sat on the bank, his face white from the effort. Connie looked at him and almost cried with anger. There was dead silence. Have you hurt yourself? She asked. No, no, he turned away irritably. At last he sighed, blew his nose and said, That pneumonia took a lot out of me. No one answered. He rose and took the handle of the chair. He was paler than Connie had ever seen him, and more distant, but she helped him push. It was surprisingly hard work. She looked at his hands, browned by the weather. Shoving with his left hand, he laid his right hand on her round white wrist, caressing it. She bent suddenly and kissed his hand. Meanwhile, the back of Clifford's head was held, sleek and motionless, just in front of them. As they paused at the top of the hill, Connie realized for the first time that she had consciously and definitely hated Clifford with a vivid hate, as if he ought to be obliterated from the face of the earth. Now I've hated him, I shall never be able to go on living with him, was the thought that crossed her mind. When they reached the house, both she and Mellors wiped the perspiration from their faces. It was curious, but their work together had brought them much closer than they had been before. Thank you so much, Mellors, said Clifford at the house door. Mellors slung his arms back into his jacket, looked directly at Connie, saluted, and was gone. Connie, furious, went upstairs. At lunch, she could not contain her feelings. Why are you so abominably inconsiderate, Clifford? She asked. Of whom? Of the keeper. If that was an illustration of what you call the ruling classes, I'm sorry for you. There's a man who's been ill and isn't strong. My word, if I were one of the working classes, I'd let you wait for service. I'd let you whistle. I can quite believe that. If he'd been sitting in a chair with paralysed legs and behaved as you behaved, what would you have done for him? My dear evangelist, replied Clifford, this confusing of persons and personalities is in bad taste. And your nasty, sterile want of common sympathy is in the worst taste imaginable. Noblesse oblige, you and your ruling class. I pay him £2 a week and give him a house for his services, argued Clifford. Pah, I would tell you to keep your £2 a week and your house, responded Connie with emphasis. Probably he would like to, but can't afford the luxury. You rule, went on Connie. You don't rule. Don't flatter yourself. Why, you're all dried up. You only bully with your money. I was utterly ashamed of you out there in the wood. Why, my father is 10 times the human being you are, you gentleman. Clifford rang the bell for Mrs. Bolton. He was yellow at the gills. Connie went up to her room, furious, saying to herself, buying people. Well, he doesn't buy me. There's no need for me to stay with him. Dead fish of a man with his celluloid soul. She made her plans for the night, determined to get Clifford off her mind. She didn't want to hate him. She didn't want him to know anything at all about herself, particularly about her feelings for the keeper. She went to bed quite early. But at 9:30, she got up and went outside to listen. There was no sound, so she slipped on her dressing gown and went downstairs. Clifford and Mrs. Bolton were playing cards, gambling. They would probably go on until midnight. She quietly returned to her room and slipped on a thin dress and a light coat. If she met anybody, she would say she was going out for a few minutes. And when she returned in the morning, she would say she had just been for a little walk, as she often did before breakfast. She slipped out silently and unseen. There was a certain anger and rebellion burning in her heart. It was not the right sort of heart to take to a love meeting. When she got to the park gate, he was already there, in the darkness of the wood. "You're good and early," he said out of the dark. "Is everything all right?" "Perfectly easy." They walked on. "Are you sure you didn't hurt yourself this morning?" she asked. "No, no." "Did you hate Clifford?" "Hate him? No. I've met too many like him to upset myself hating him. I don't care for his sort. A sort of youngish gentleman, a bit like a lady. He's tame, but nasty with it." They reached the cottage. It was warm after the chill outside. Connie sat with her stockinged feet on the bright steel fender, her coat off. She turned from the fire to look around. How bare the little room was. She noticed a large photograph of a young married couple, him with a bold-faced young woman, no doubt his wife. Connie remarked on it, asking if he kept it for sentimental reasons. "No," he replied. "I never look at it. I hardly knowed it was there. It's been there since we come to this place." "Why don't you burn it?" she asked. "It wouldn't be a bad idea, would it?" he replied. Having put on his slippers, he took the photograph and prized it from its frame, looking at it with amusement. "Shows me for what I was, a young curate, and her for what she was, a bully," he commented wryly. He broke up the card and placed it on the fire. The glass and backboard followed. He broke the frame asunder. Having cleared away, he sat down. "Why don't you get a divorce?" asked Connie. "She'll come back to you one day." "She wouldn't come within a mile of me. She hates me a lot worse than I hate her." "But you're not even legally separated, are you?" "No." "Ah, well," said Connie, "then she'll come back, and you'll have to take her in." Mellors gazed at Connie. "You may be right," he replied. "I was a fool ever to come back here, but I felt stranded and had to go somewhere. But you're right. I'll get a divorce and get clear of her." His face was set. Inwardly, she exulted. After a while, he spoke again. "When I was first clear of her, I wanted nothing to do with women any more. I wanted to keep myself to myself, keep my privacy and my decency." He looked pale and somber. "And were you sorry when I came along?" Connie asked. "I was sorry, and I was glad." "And what are you now?" she asked. "I'm sorry for the outside, all the complications and the ugliness and recrimination that's bound to come sooner or later. That's when my blood sinks and I'm low. But when my blood comes up, I'm glad. I'm even triumphant. When I can forget all the rest, I'm glad." "Forget then," she whispered, "forget." He held her close in the flickering warmth of the fire. Slowly his blood kindled and began to ebb back with strength and reckless vigour once more. "What do you believe in?" she asked. "I don't know." They were both silent. Then he roused himself. "Yes, I do believe in something. I believe in being warm-hearted. I believe especially in being warm-hearted in love, in fucking with a warm heart. But the women don't like it. Even you don't really like it. Where's your tenderness for me? You're as suspicious as a cat is of a dog. Your own self-importance is more important to you 50 times more than any man." She watched at him. "What's come between us?" she faltered as a dimness came over her. He took her in his arms, pressing her against his body, which somehow felt hurt right through. "My lass," he murmured. "Don't let's fight. Let's be together." She looked up at him. "Don't be upset. It's no good being upset. Do you really want to be with me?" "Aye, aye," he replied, sniffing faintly. Having regained a measure of composure, they went to bed quickly, where they both went to sleep at once, fast, in one sleep. And so they lay and never moved, until the sun rose over the wood and day was beginning anew. Then he woke and looked at the light. It would be a brilliant morning. Connie was still curled up asleep, tender. His hand moved over her, and she opened her blue, wondering eyes, smiling. "Fancy that we're here," she whispered. They stirred each other, slipping off their nightclothes. As a man's body quivered, he heard the distant hooters of Stack's Gate announcing 7 o'clock. It was Monday morning. He shivered a little. She had not even heard the hooters.
lying perfectly still, Connie's soul washed transparently.
"You must get up, mustn't you?" he muttered. "Them was the 7 o'clock blowers."
"I suppose I must."
She watched as he sat up. "You do love me, don't you?" she asked calmly.
"Thou knows what thou knows," he replied.
"I want you to keep me, not to let me go."
"Don't ask me now. Let me be. But I like thee."
After a while, he dressed himself swiftly in silence, glanced at her once as she still lay naked in the golden light, and was gone. She heard him opening the door downstairs, and still she lay musing. It was very hard to go. He called up, 7:30. She sighed and got out of bed. The bare little room. But there were books. So, he was a reader. The sun fell on her naked limbs through the gable window. If only she could stay. If only he would make her part of his world. She dressed and went downstairs.
"Will you wait anything?" he asked.
"No, only lend me a comb." She combed her hair and was ready to go. She stood in the little garden. "I would like to have all the rest of the world disappear," she said, "and live here with you."
"It won't disappear," was his reply.
They went through the lovely wood together in a world of their own. It was bitter to her to have to go on to Ragby Hall. "I want to come and live with you soon," she said as she left him. He smiled, unanswering. She got home quickly and unnoticed went up to her room. Clifford talked to her about all his serious schemes, and she listened in a kind of wonder, letting him talk. Then the flow suddenly ceased and he became blank, while apparently his schemes coiled on and on inside him, like an odd kind of dream. All the while, it seemed to Connie, Clifford was really going deader.